Welcome to St. Matthew's Episcopal Church for our celebration of the third Sunday in Easter. And we extend our welcome, of course, to those who are here in the church, but to those who are worshiping with us online at this time. Our worship service begins on page 355 in the red prayer book found in your pew, page 355. Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings from Holy Scripture.
A reading from the Revelation to John. I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels surrounding the throne and the living creatures and the elders. They numbered myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, singing with full voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing, "To the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have caught no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew that it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He felt hurt because he said to him a third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly, I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, "Follow me." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Please be seated. There is so much, so many phrases and words and signs and symbols in this passage. I would need to break them up for several Sundays, or we'll be here a very long time to preach it all. So we're going to get a little focused on an aspect of this. I do take plenty of courage that of all the things that are in that passage, right? Jesus appears to his disciples on the Sea of Galilee, appearing to them as they have already seen the resurrection. We heard of that over these past few Sundays. They knew that Christ was risen, and he continues to appear to them. And first of all, for some of you who need to know this, it seems that Jesus loves fishing. So he's out with his disciples when they're out fishing. He also loves a barbecue, right? Because he's out grilling fish outside on the side of the beach. So Jesus loves fishing, and he loves a good barbecue, and appeared to them there. And in the middle of that story, we hear of the miraculous event, the catch of the fish, right? That Simon, Peter, James, and John, and all the others who were with him had been fishing all night and came up with nothing. And pulled the net up from the water, and it was just water just running back through down into the Sea of Galilee. Came up with nothing. And then when they heeded the word of Christ, they saw Jesus on the seashore. He said, "Have you got anything yet?" And they said, "No." He said, "Well, you're fishing on the wrong side of the boat. Try the other side. The fish are not here, but they're here." And he tries again, and they pull up the huge catch of fish out from the deep, yanking those fish up into the boat so heavy that the nets were strained but not broken. And there were, it says, 153 fish that they got. I love that somebody, I guess, counted them. And wrote that down. And somebody said, "You know, we're going to want to remember this later. We're going to want to remember, how many did we get? Oh, it was 100. You know, quick, Thomas, write that down." And they wrote it down. And there's been many people over centuries of Christians who have read the story. They want to know, why? Why would you bother to write that down at all? Why, if it means anything, does it mean anything? Or is it just, we're going to be literalists and say, well, that's how many there were. Thomas counted them, and that's wrote it down. That's the end of it. But there's been all of this wondering about that number, 153. There are plenty of people who have tried to do some kind of almost numerology to come to a mystical meaning that, well, there's a 3, so that's the Trinity, and there's 150 left. So if we take 7 times 20 plus 10, if we take these sort of biblical numbers and arrange them, ooh, 153, and it means something about God. Or if you take all of the letters in the name Mary Magdalene and write them in Greek and give them all a number and add them up, you get 153, and you get some kind of like Dan Brown, Da Vinci Code kind of answer about trying to come up with these like mystical answers. But one commentator, an ancient Christian commentator writing about this, St. Jerome, was writing about this, and he said, this is hundreds of years ago, this is the 4th century that he was writing, and he said that in his studies of the world, there were 153 kinds of fish in the world. That's how many species of fish the ancient biologists thought were in the world. They were wrong. I mean, that's not right. We know there's way more species of fish than 153. But he was trying to use the science of his day, what he knew about God's creation and about nature, to help understand the story. Right, 153 kinds of fish, the exact number that they draw up out of the water. That is to say that not a single kind was left behind. Every single kind that there is was caught up in the net in the miracle of Jesus. A few things we might want to think about alongside that. First of all, there's only one net. Of all the different kinds of fish out there, there was not 2 nets, one for the kosher fish and the non-kosher fish. There was not 2 nets out there. All of them came together with Jesus. All of them together. We know that they reached down into the depths of the water to pull that up, a symbol of the resurrection, down where Jesus had been buried into the earth and laid for 3 days before his mighty resurrection, that Christ is risen and he's going to bring everybody, one of every single kind, with him in the strength of resurrection. That not one kind, not one person would be left missing. A number of years ago, I was serving a church, and a church member had died, and they were looking to put a memorial window right over the church altar. And they were putting in a window there, and they decided over trying to figure out what would be in the window to do Jesus the Good Shepherd. You know, they're holding the lamb. You know, he's got a little staff and a little lamb and sheep behind it following along. And as we got the drawings from the stained glass window artist, she showed us what she was planning to make in her sketches. And one of the church members said, "No, that's not right. Send it back." She said, "There's no black sheep in the flock. There's only white sheep in the flock." And she said, "I'm the weirdo. I'm the misfit. I'm the black sheep. I want to be in that flock too. I won't be left out. Send it back and try again." And then we built the window. She built the window and we had it installed. And over the years, people kept coming to me over and over again. And they said, "That's me. I'm the weirdo, I'm the misfit, I'm the black sheep in my family, and I have a place in the flock too. I have a place with Jesus, the Good Shepherd. That's me up there when you see that." I kind of think if we all were a little more honest about the fact that we're all misfits and weirdos, we probably wouldn't have to worry about that quite as much. But there was a place for everyone who found themselves in that window. And so we see that there was all together in that one net, 153 fish, one of every single kind. There was not going to be two nets. There was not one for the misfit fish and one for the good fish that everybody liked. There was not going to be a rich fish and a poor fish. There was not a net for black, brown, and white. There was not going to be a Republican net and a Democrat net. There was going to be one net for everybody. And the symbol of the resurrection, that we would all be caught up together in one place with no one left behind. There were the fish that were profitable to sell in the market, those who were worth a lot of money. And they got the fish that you don't really get to sell for very much, all the anchovies and stuff that was in there, right? The ones that don't make you a lot of money. There's going to be the fish in there that are beautiful and attractive to look at, and then there's the ugly fish are going to be in there too. In that net were the fish that you might want to keep as a pet at home, and then there's also the crabs that are going to pinch you. And there's going to be the jellyfish that are going to sting you. There's going to be in that net the hard-shelled oysters, those that have built up their defenses for years and years and have a big hard shell to protect them from the world around them. They were in the net. Two, every single kind was going to be there. And that was our message for the resurrection. 153, that's what that number meant. Well, you didn't even notice it, did you? It just kind of goes right by you, but there was so much to tell us of what the power of the resurrection of Jesus is able to do. To raise us up all together, not one of us left behind. And so we say that alleluia, not only alleluia that Christ is risen, but he's bringing all of us with him. He's bringing you with him. He's bringing me along with him. And every single one, even the ones that pinch and sting and have hard shells and we don't otherwise want to include, but everybody's going to be there for alleluia, Christ is risen. And he's bringing you and me and all of us together with him. Amen. Knowing that we are risen with him, let us proclaim our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed on page 358 of the Book of Common Prayer. Page 358.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made,
Please join me in the prayers of the people found on page 388 in the Red Book of Common Prayer. And we will respond, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. This week, we celebrate the birthdays of Keen McCann, Michael Simons, Alicia Bellamy, Bennett, Bellany Bennett, Andrea Lingley, Dennis Tennant, and Kiva Penny, and the anniversaries of David Betts and Lynn Scott, and Eric and Karen Batty. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, and spirit. Nora, Keith, Martha, Caleb, Brian, Ava, Linda, Lisa, Josh, Judith Ann, Donnie, Eddie, and Bree. Give them courage and hope in their troubles and bring them the joy of your salvation. We also pray for those who are homebound or hospitalized or in nursing homes, including Marilyn, Marjorie, Jamila, Barbara, Lorette, Sally, and Sue. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commend to your mercy all who have died, including Bill Exner, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Almighty God, you have linked our lives together, one with another, so that all that we do affects for good and for ill all other lives. So guide us in the work that we do, that we may do it not for self alone, but for the common good. And as we seek a proper return for our own labor, make us mindful of the rightful aspirations of other workers and arouse our concern for those who have no work. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Share with each other a sign of Christ's peace, and we extend that peace to those who are worshiping online with us at this time. Jesus said, "You are the light of the world. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and give thanks to your Father who is in heaven." The Great Thanksgiving continues on page 367 with Eucharistic Prayer B, page 367. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God. It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. And as we prepare to receive communion here in the church, we join our prayers to those who are receiving communion spiritually online at this time. Let us pray with them. Loving God, make me aware of your presence in this Eucharist and wherever I may be today. Grant that I may always know the sacred and abiding experience of your presence through Christ our Lord. Amen. Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. On page 365, let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for just a couple of announcements before we depart this morning. First of all, I do want to share that we do have coffee hour set up downstairs in the parish hall in the Undercroft. So please stick around for coffee, cookies, and all sorts of other things. So thank you to James and Nancy for making that happen. When you go down, you will see cookies, fruit, and you will see the coffee hour sign-up sheet as well on that table. So as you make your way down and you're so grateful to have your coffee and your cookie this morning, remind yourself that we need volunteers to make that happen. And if we don't have the volunteers, we won't have a coffee hour. So please, there's several of the Sundays in May are already filled out, but I think there's a few blank ones that are waiting for you to help out to make those happen. So please do volunteer for coffee hour. At the back of the church, we do have the new forward day-by-day booklets. We have the big size and the pocket size as well. Please pick one up. Today is May 1st, and this has a devotion for every day of May, June, and July. So you can take those with you to have a place for just a five-minute reflection on the scriptures every day to help you in your spiritual growth. And coming up this week, the announcement is here in the bulletin, we have the class, online Zoom class coming up for our adult faith formation called What is Resurrection? As we go through this season of Easter celebrating the resurrection of Christ, that will have a Zoom class Wednesday nights starting on May 4th. It will be a short video to watch and a discussion to be had after, and you can do that while you're at home having dinner, and you can bring your plate over to your computer or tablet or whatever, and just be a part of that however is best for you. If you would like to join that, the Zoom link to click is sent out in the weekly parish notes email that we have. If you get our parish notes, you will get that, and you can just click it at 7 o'clock on Wednesday to join. If you are not on our email list and want to be, there are cards in your pew that say welcome. Fill them out, put down your email address. You can give it to me after church, and I will make sure that we get you added to that list. Other announcements before we go, things I might have missed. Oh, Nancy. Thank you. Now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Christ is thine.
cease to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia.